Learning Lectures ELL is a brainchild of Sanjay Sahai. It was launched on 19th May 2012 with a noble intention to disseminate top-class management learning to the teaching, student and the practitioners fraternity. The ELL team moved a step further in their goal from management for all to knowledge for all. Every ELL is designed to be a product for it increases its shelf life. The product can be replicated as and when requested, maintaining the quality and documentation. Every ELL comprises of experiential lecture, PowerPoint presentation of the same, an article, feedback of all participants, feedback analysis, and relevant video footage of the lecture. The complete product is available free of cost on www.ellectures.com. These lectures can be organized at the organization's request at the earliest possible time and would be delivered by Sahai or one of his team members conversant with the topic. Based on his knowledge, enthusiasm, interest, and experience, Sahai is eminently qualified to speak to us on ethical issues. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sanjay Sahai, our guest speaker today. I request our principal, Dr. P. Nagaraj, to please come onto the dais to welcome Sanjay Sahai with a flower sapling. Ladies and gentlemen, now the most awaited session is going to start. I'm sure all of you are eagerly waiting to listen to Sanjay Sahai. He's a man for every reason and a man for every season. Sanjay Sahai is well known to all of us. He's a celebrity speaker par excellence. He's an IPS officer who's got 360 degrees experience of all policing tasks and has achieved several milestones in his career, from policing to networking to creation of a state-of-the-art data center, the one and only one owned by any police organization in the country. Karnataka today is the leading state in the crime and criminal tracking network system, CCTNS Mission Mode project of Government of India. And this project aims at complete computerization of Indian police. And the man responsible for this is none other than Sanjay Sahai. He's a proficient national and international speaker on large number of IT, technology, personality development, and management topics. He is an epitome of knowledge, excellent orator, with a remarkable command of language, a gifted voice, with the capacity to connect to audience. He's an academician, motivating people by his knowledge and interesting outlook on various issues. He loves to work in various fields with as much perfection as possible, and teaching is his passion. He's an avid reader, eloquent and skilled public speaker, prolific writer. At present, he's writing a book entitled A Project Called Life, Professionalism Turned Upside Down. He's a leader in his own right. He has a catalyzed case study done by two senior professors of Tapni Manipal on his leadership style and the process through which he brought computerization to Karnataka, making it robust and irreversible. Sahai has received a number of honors and recognition for his work. Steve Jobs is his role model. Sahai's activities are profiled in various websites. And my introduction about Sahai has been just the tip of an iceberg. And there's a lot to know about this great thought leader. You may visit his websites. Ladies and gentlemen, let us give a huge round of applause to our guest speaker. Even I am waiting to listen to him. And it's over to Sanjay Sahai.
Good afternoon, everybody. ELL, as has been told to you, started with the noble intention of dissemination of management education to one and all. The business schools have a limited role to provide education to the limited few at rates and fees which are not acceptable to most of us in this country. I feel that the only way you can move ahead and be globally recognized is to work with appropriate technology and scientific management principles. That is the core, that is my platform, and that day takes me from one sector to the other. Today, we are extremely happy at ELL that we are moving on to the medical field. I could never join a medical college, and the nearest I reach medical colleges is when I interact with the faculty, the clinical practitioners, and the students.
We are at the fourth edition of ELL. We started on 19th of May 2012, and over a period of 8 months, though still being young, we have been able to reach lot many sectors. We have been able to cover technology management, and today we are in the medical field. The genesis of today's lecture goes back to somewhere in September 2011, when I was invited by JJMC for an annual function or so, if I remember correctly. And over the course of preparing that lecture, I decided to flip over a couple of relevant material, wherein I found something which is very well known to you, is a nexus between lot many stakeholders in the complete overall medical system. I talked about that the people who appreciated, and somewhere down the line, somewhere in my subconscious mind, I got this idea, why not medical ethics? I'd like to do a bit of a marketing of my ELL. 8 months, whatever we have slogged, now we are moving out of Davanagere as well. On 27th, I'm giving a talk on leading through conflict, which was our ELL3. Every ELL is named, it is typed as a product, and it is let out in the market as a social service product. So ELL moves to Manipal, ELL moves to Mangalore, and there are a lot many resource persons who are with us. Dr. Raman of the TAPI Management Institute, who attended the last lecture, was kind enough to be the coordinator for Manipal. We have a gentleman called Anand Prabhu, who has been in this field. He's been computer and IT guy. So he has invited me for the same lecture on the very same day in the evening, leading through conflict at Mangalore. That is at the Sahyadri College of Engineering. We also start from today what we call as the ELL think tank. We will have a couple of people who would be the overall think tank members, and I would request a couple of the eminent people who have gathered here to listen to today's lecture to be as a part of the think tank. There will be overall think tank, there will be think tanks for each of the ELLs, and that is how we will move forward. We'll also be having coordinators for individual ELLs. We'll be deciding on a coordinator for ELL Ethicos for Medicos. Ethicos for Medicos is just the initiation of a process. It is a huge exercise, and I presume in the days to come, it would be a product in itself, and we will roll it across the whole state. We will roll it across the country with a very, very sweet and a cherished dream that we will be able to make a difference in the medical services which is being provided to every single individual in this country. And today, we are also inaugurating something called ELL for People. So that will be an interactive part of our portal that will provide you articles, that will provide you collaborators, the institutions who would associate with us, they will be our collaborators. We will get into ELL competitions. We will get into ELL young group. So lot many things it will be to make ELL more people friendly, more interactive, more impact making, and more transformational. The medical field has progressed immensely, technologically, resource-wise, human resource-wise, spread-wise, I think in nearly every single way, providing different models of development with various business models and various models of education. Some might be good, some might be bad, some might be somewhere in the middle of the spectrum. The services have moved further, but somewhere we feel the pinch. If we go in for a national survey today, we'll find very few people who are satisfied with the medical services. It is not a scathing comment on the medical services, a scathing comment on this country, and not that many people will be satisfied with the police services, the governance of this country. So we have for you Ethicos for Medicos. We are trying to reach out to all stakeholders, and what we intend to do is social change through knowledge. Society is the only stakeholder for all of us in whatever profession we might be, in whatever occupation might be, whatever we might be doing. Society is the only recipient of all our products and services. There is absolutely no denying the fact that anybody who becomes exclusive, distinct of society does not have a long shelf life. This lecture is primarily built on pure academic knowledge, which is available in the public domain. It's nothing which I have created, but I've tried my level best to put into place, give you a semblance of what is happening. You know what is the wider canvas, where you fit in, and what you can do for your profession, for your job, for your organization, for the society and nation at large. One patent, one innovation can change the face of this nation. Unfortunately, it's not happening. So it's a life beyond boundaries. It is there for everybody. As I move ahead in the lecture, you will see that most of the management principles we have been talking about, after a lot of deliberation, after a lot of embarrassment outside India, finally the national accreditation scheme or program has started. Presently voluntary in nature, but certainly it will not be long when it would become mandatory. So it's a life beyond boundaries. This is one thing I think all the academicians and practitioners in the medical fraternity would remember of. And this first line of your declaration on day one, you join medical service, I think is sufficient to carry you through your whole professional career. And if you intend to retire, very, very few of the medical practitioners retire. If you do, I think it will take you through for the rest of your life as well. Which reads, I solemnly pledge myself to consecrate my life to the service of humanity. I don't think any NGO in this world has got a vision statement like this. So if this is the vision statement of every single medical practitioner all across the globe, do we need any NGOs? We have different oaths, different slogans, different visions, different systems thinking for every single business organization. But this is one single fraternity where they are convinced of the fact that this is only one single goal they have in life, and that is to consecrate themselves in the service of humanity. I am not the right person to elaborate what is service of humanity, and I think your education, your internship and your service, whether in the governmental sector, whether in the private sector or whatever sector it might be, I think this is the only goal which you can have in life. I'll maintain the utmost respect for human life from the time of conception. What happens between conception and delivery, I think it is a very well-known thing in this country. And despite large number of legislations to the contrary, I think that evil practice still goes on. So ethics starts playing with human existence. Practitioners start playing with human existence from the day conception starts. The health of my patient will be my first consideration. If health of the patient is the first consideration, I don't think there is any patient who should be bothered about himself. There is some godly person who is there to take care of you from the beginning to the end. My own personal story, I was suffering from appendicitis, which I was told later. I visited nearly 8 to 10 hospitals between 1982 to 1985, and a couple of them were very famed hospitals. To cut the story short, finally, after 3 years of running around and getting admitted into one hospital after another, meeting innumerable experts, I landed with acute peritonitis. I was operated upon after 72 hours in Patna instead of Delhi, and continue to survive till today. I will maintain by all means the honor and noble traditions of the medical profession. See, this is one thing which you should be proud of. This is one thing which should be your cherished dream. The day your profession loses name and reputation, that day it will be extremely difficult for you as an individual to live in a society which would look up to you. It has happened with large number of professions, couple of very famed professions, couple of professions which run this country. Nonetheless, nobody looks at them. You keep your profession intact, even if you have a bit less of humanity, at least you would be interested in the fact that your professionalism, your profession lives, survives and gets the respect which from times immemorial you have been getting. Why play around with that? I've been reading lots and lots of judgments. I've seen scathing remarks against investigation. I've seen scathing remarks against chartered accountants, engineers, and God knows whom. It's the only profession which is talked so high in judgment after judgment after judgment, where the law tries, where the Supreme Court tries not to disturb you while you are delivering your service, is only the medical profession. For our sake and for your sake, please keep it intact. Otherwise, days will not be good either for the patient or for the medical practitioner. All doctors are familiar with the fact that the first and foremost is the symptomatic analysis. So this is where your symptoms are. In a life system where supposedly the patient is at the center of the universe and rest everything revolves around him, what we see is this is known as the Swiss cheese model of accident causation. It was created in the year 1990, and starting from leadership, policies, procedures, available resources, communication, there are gaping holes in each of them, which gets reflected by excessive cost cutting, equipment shortages, communication issues, poor compliance, deficient training program and the like. These are on the latent side. What you see are the news headlines. And those news headlines, I don't think it carries anything good for any fraternity. So there are barriers to accidents. And the first barrier they talk about is leadership. Let me make one thing very, very clear. Whatever we talk about the profession, whatever we talk about the camaraderie, whatever we talk about conduct principles and the like. There are leaders in every community, and I'm not referring to political leaders. They are the people who guide the destiny of that particular organization. And if we have 50 medical leaders who are ready to guide the destiny of the medical professionals and the medical profession in the manner all of us want, and in the same way as you want, I think the medical landscape of this country is bound to change. I don't think any medical practitioner would be happy to be treated in the manner I was treated for 3 years in Delhi between 1982 to 1985. If your sons and daughters land up in the same problem, we'll see how humanity overflows. Everybody, I think every human being, he has the same issue, which faces the same problem. So these are the failures in the system. And finally, what you see in the newspapers is wrong side surgery, medication error, fall and the like. There is one more issue which is involved. I've spent more time on the thoughts, most times on concepts, more time on whatever I want you to carry back from this lecture. I don't want you to carry whatever is already quoted by Medical Council of India. I don't want to carry, I don't want you to carry something which has been the proceedings of a trial. I don't want you to carry some procedures, formulas or things of that nature. What I want you is to understand the whole gamut of stakeholders, their interconnect, the overall connect, and go out of this place with what we call as a systems thinking. Systems thinking will give you an overall idea as to where you stand. Coming to the lecture as such, we'll be touching ethics, conduct, medical negligence, legal status and quality standards. I have my experience in governance, I have my experience in management, technology, human behavior, organizational behavior, change management and the like. And somewhere down the line, I think that sort of a knowledge is able to take care both hospital administration, ethics, medical service and what we can see as a roadmap for medical services in this country based on quality standards, based on quality human resource, based on attitudinal changes and the like. The patient's comfort zone is your mission in life. It is not giving him some medicines, prescribing something, asking him to meet you at some amount of periodicity and the like. He should feel comfortable with the medical practitioner. It might be a small interaction, it might be a long interaction, it might be an lifelong interaction.